Okay, I believe we have a very fine gentleman on the phone. He's always jet-setting, so I'm not quite sure where he is. I'm excited to find out. Kieran Sidhu, the CEO of Halo Labs, halocanada.com. How you doing, man?
I'm doing well. How you doing?
I'm giddy today. I had a coffee. I had like a frappuccino. Got me going, you know?
I had one of those, one of those Keurig hotel coffees. I had a Lavazza with some of that, powdered milk and a little white sugar. So I'm in about the same giddy mood.
So you're in a hotel. Whereabouts are you?
I'm actually in Austin, Texas. I took a day to watch my daughter play some tennis at an ITF tournament down here, and it's a wonderful 100 degrees in the shade. But I'll be back in LA tomorrow at it.
You've mentioned the cannabis scene before in Texas. Where are we at now with the way things are progressing that way?
I think Texas is still a little bit behind the curve. It's an interesting state. Where I sit here in Austin is, very pro, and some of the western parts of the states like El Paso are very pro. But I think it's, I think it's a little bit of a challenge here relative to some of the other states. But, Utah just approved medical unanimously. So, in Oklahoma and Iowa. So, it's just a matter of time.
Yeah, definitely. More messages that get across, the more stigmas are ending. And I think once people start to wrap their head around job creation and tax benefits and all this kind of stuff for the people of your country, more people might go, okay, this is better than opioids. Let's talk about your company and Halo and everything you're doing there at Halo Labs. Matt, that I'm a big stock guy, and full disclosure, I'm invested in your company. But I looked at the volume today, what went on. It was off the charts.
Yeah, we've been really, really, especially myself, I've been really sort of trying to get the message out there, especially during the cannabis stocks have had a little bit of a hard time, a little bit of a hard run recently. A lot of people say it's a buying opportunity. To me, it's just, being on the other side of it, it's a little bit morbid. But today we had a good day. The stock had a good day, and tomorrow I'm in L.A. At a Canaccord event. Then on Saturday I'm at a Green Chips event in San Francisco. And then the following week I'm at another Canaccord event in Toronto. And then Friday I did a nice simulcast with Rich Live TV. He's a great guy, great little show he's got going. And, we're just out there messaging the story. I think a nice article was published on MJObserver.com today as well. So, it's just a question of getting the story out there.
Great story, and obviously, sounding biased here, I'm such a big believer in your company, and you being the CEO, clearly you are too. But why? I mean, and I don't know what you can and can't say as the CEO of a company, but why would you say that your company you would probably feel is an undervalued stock right now, meaning there's a lot of progress, a lot of great things to come, and really a good buying opportunity? Can you say stuff like that?
Well, no, I'm not going to talk about whether to buy or sell our stock, but I can talk to you a little bit about, in the long term, I think we're unique because we're the only U.S. publicly traded cannabis stock that's, put our stake down in Lesotho, which is a mountain kingdom, constitutional monarchy in the center of South Africa. Afria's there, Canopy's there, Supreme's there, and who else? Someone else large is there. But Canopy, Supreme, Afria there, and a company called Meta Kingdom. And we're there as well. And like them, we're big believers in Lesotho. And we believe that, it will become sort of the worldwide breadbasket, or at least different parts of Africa, for cannabis. And the reason behind that is an interesting one. Because if you think about, foreign exporters of CBD oil, you think about China, right? You think about India and countries like that for agrarian output. But because of their stigmatism and their legal postures on cannabis, they're behind the curve. And Lesotho is progressive, and, South Africa is now decriminalized. It's getting really progressive. And so they're taking, they're carpe diem. They're seizing the opportunity. And we're there in full force. And I think it's, you know, I think it's just a great spot. And I think it's going to be great for, you know, our shareholders and great for medical patients in general.
Yeah, we had talked about Lesotho, and you mentioned, you know, the amount, the potential amount of cannabis that could actually be grown there. Have you guys started production?
Well, we've just put our nursery up, and we have our babies being born. You know, it's tricky, you know, internationally to bring clones in and all of the good stuff we do in North America. So you have to actually start from seeds, and you germinate seeds. And we've been doing that now for about, I believe, 90 to 120 days. Remember that you're south of the equator, so the planting season is the exact opposite. So we hope to have those babies in forced-air greenhouses, 1 hectare to start, but a total of 5 hectares, which is 11 acres, which to us is a very, very large grow. I mean, even by Canadian standards, I think that's a large grow. And we hope to have the first hectare planted in a forced-air greenhouse in the November timeframe. And to that extent, we're actually leveling our land now, dredging our land, and doing all of that. So, it's real, and we hope to have our first crop out by May. And we're adhering to what's known as GACP, which is good agricultural current practice, so we can export it to hopefully Israel, Australia, or somewhere in Europe.
Great to hear. How does it work for security in a place like Lesotho when you start to grow, when these babies start turning into, you know, beautiful buds?
You know, Lesotho is a mountain kingdom. It has the Deputy Prime Minister loves to say it has the lowest low and the highest high point out of any country. And it has a culture of cannabis. And it has a, you know, it's a, as I said, it has a king and it has a tribal culture. So, you know, we don't have the security issues you have, let's say, in the Emerald Triangle outside of California. I'm sure we'll put like a guard or two up, you know, cameras up and everything we normally do and all our seed to sale tracking software. But, you know, I feel very safe there. And, you know, it's an open door climate. It's very, very different, you know, from, let's say, Johannesburg or other places in South Africa. It's a pretty safe and secure environment up there.
When are we doing our remote there, Kieran? That's what I want to know. Kieran Sidhu from Halo Labs. I want to do a show.
We should definitely do it in November once we get those. By those times, there'll be teenagers. Get those teenagers in the greenhouse. It'll be a big deal for us.
Do plants? It sounds like a dumb question here. Do they talk about plants in year, like, you know, dogs have dog years compared? Do they actually use terminology like that?
Oh yeah, definitely. In a typical greenhouse environment, you would get 3 grows. You know, it's not a perpetual harvest like a indoor environment. Putting that aside, you have 3 growing cycles. But, you know, we talk about them when they're seedlings, you know, when they're babies, when they're teenagers. And then, you know, in North America in July, August, in August and September, that we say they start to stretch, right? Like, you know, like a teenager starts to become an adult. So we definitely use that, you know, language, like plants are in full stretch, and then inevitably they blossom, right? And when they blossom, you know, the flowers come out and they're all females, right? Remember, you want to keep the males away. I call it the frustrated female scenario. And they secrete oleoresin to attract the male pollen. And that oleoresin is the active ingredient that we all smoke within the plant. And so what you want to do is you want to catch it right when the oleoresin is secreted the most, but before the flower starts to die.
I mean, what a great, fantastic little history lesson, you know, simplified. I love that. That's a great little audio clip right there. I'm looking at my producer as I say that. That's a lot of people don't even know the how that kind of works, you know, what they end up buying. Speaking of where they end up buying, how's the California dispensary business going?
Well, you know, that is our big focus. So if Lesotho is the medium to long-term, you know, goal of the company, the short term is California dispensaries coming back to this side of the planet, in north of the equator. And we're really making a big push. I mean, Nabis, I don't know if you saw it. It's not the public company Nabis, but the California Nabis company. They just did a big round, who's our partner distributor. It was, you know, the who's who of the Silicon Valley was involved in the Nabis round. You know, one of the big delivery companies, I think Postmates, and a couple of big venture capitalists. They have really sophisticated software, really sophisticated trucks. And, you know, we're just starting to load them up, and our guys are going out there. I think we're in about 55 dispensaries already. We hope to be in 100 in the next 2 weeks. And, you know, there are only five to 600 legal dispensaries in California. And if by the end of the year we're in 200 to 300 of those dispensaries, man, we're doing really, really well. And don't forget, you know, we have a good white label relationship we're developing with Caliva. And we also have a great relationship with Ease, which is probably the largest dispensary on the planet, if people don't know. And Ease is a virtual dispensary. So in California and now in Nevada, I believe, and in Oregon, you download the Ease app, you order your product, and they have these depots. And people come in cars, they deliver it to your home, you pay for it. And I think Ease's numbers are something like 8 to 10 million U.S. a month, but don't quote me. They're a private company. And so we're doing a lot of work with them as well. So California, you know, we are really, really positive on. And what differentiates us, again, from everyone else in California is we exclusively have dab tabs, you know, so people can get that live resin, full concentrate experience, you know, in an easy-to-use vape pen-style format. You know, without all the hassle of dabbing.
Karen Sidhu, who joins us, you mentioned Ease too. I guess their original pitch must have been the Uber of cannabis. Was it something like that?
Yeah, I don't know if Uber. I don't know if Uber would allow them to do that, but they definitely. They definitely have, you know, made amazing strides, and they're, you know, they're just another class company.
Good
you
team.
Know, I think the founder of Ease was also the founder of Yammer or something like that. But again, don't hold me to it.
And one of the things we talked about with some of these sort of depleted stock prices and everything was to look to a lot of mergers might happen. Have mergers been happening in the marijuana space?
You know, everyone seems to ask me that question, you know, and it's it has been one of, you know, when you go to these conferences, you feel like you're in serial speed dating, right? And you don't know, you know, you don't know if, you know, someone wants to buy you, you want to buy someone, everyone's talking to everyone, you know, it's just, there's just so much speed dating happening. But, you know, my philosophy of all of that is obviously you don't kick a gift horse in the mouth, as we say down here. But at the same time, you know, we just can't be distracted by it. We just got to focus on executing. You know, we got that $10 million deadline. We're working on some other stuff. And it's just a question of just executing the plan, you know, and if we execute the plan, you know, we're going to do well and create good value for everybody, you know. But obviously, if a gift horse comes, you don't kick it in the mouth, you know. If it makes everyone, you know, makes everyone good money, you know, you do it.
Well, good to know, and great to hear these wonderful company updates from you and your team over at Halo Labs, HaloCanada.com. Can't wait to do that remote in Africa, in Lesotho, the Mountain Kingdom. That sounds really cool. And Kieran, it's always great to catch up with you, really. Very well spoken. I appreciate your time.
Hey, thanks for having me, Todd.
Cheers, Kieran Sidhu, everyone from Halo.